Good morning. It's good to see you all here today. Today's July 11th, 2021. And welcome to Mountain View Bible Fellowship Sunday morning worship service. Just a reminder, we are recording the service, just so you're aware of that. Please, let's join together and stand and sing.
Here, shout the news to everyone. It's a new day, peace has come. Jesus saves, mercy triumphs at the cross. Love has come to rescue us. Jesus saves. Hope is here, what a joy. Hearts can be remade. Jesus saves. Sing above the storms of life. Sing it through the darkest night. Jesus saves. Free at last. What a joyful noise we'll make as we join in heaven's song. To let let all the world know that Jesus saves. He saved, he healed, restored, revealed the Father's heart to us. He rose to raise us from the grave. Your Spirit lives in us. Sing it out to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout. To let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout. To let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout. To let all the world know that Jesus saves.
Hope when our hearts
God who calls
Please be seated.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody who's visiting this morning. We are very pleased that you are here. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning. We ask that you would be with us and help us. Help us, Father, in everything we do, in everything we say, that it'll be to your glory. There's a wonderful old hymn that encapsulates what we're talking about here today. And it goes, "He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with us, and he talks with us along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. And I pray that each and every one of us, Father, will shout from the rooftops that he loves us and that he lives within us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen."
How are you this morning? How am I? I'm well. But you know, at any point, at any time, anything can happen to knock you off. And it's happened this morning. And so, things. And I don't think I'm knocked off per se, but I'm needing to depend. You know, I can't do this. Whatever it is that's supposed to happen in the next 45 minutes or so, communication of Christ, the clarity of God's word, teaching in such a manner that you have every opportunity to know the Lord better in an hour from now than you do right now. You understand? That's what has been requested of me, is to teach God's scriptures in such a manner that you, as his children, have every opportunity to know him more in an hour's time than you do now. That's always the path we're on, right? We're not on a stagnant. It wouldn't be a path if it was stagnant, would it be? It'd be a point. It'd be a spot. We're not on a spot. We're on a path. We're walking. Day in, day out, throughout each of those days, we're walking. And since we're walking and moving forward, not just presumably, but in reality, later on today, by walking in Christ on his path, we can know him more. Not just we may know him more, we can. It is a distinct possibility that we can know him more later today than we do this moment. Do you realize that? And when he gathers us together on these Sunday mornings, that's the express purpose, is that we would know him more at the end of our Sunday morning together. So when we launch, And it's been said, I don't know when those signs were put up over the doors. Does anybody know? You are now entering the mission field? Does anybody know when those signs went up? Probably Fred would be my best resource. They've been up for a while, a good long while. Well, and we might get used to seeing them, and it's fine. We don't have to, you know, continually remind ourselves per se we're going out to the mission field. Because even the term mission field is not necessarily a biblical term, necessarily. But we gather together on Sunday morning, so in an hour's time, we have every opportunity to know him more. So when we go out to whomever is out there, they have every opportunity to know him. Because we are the vehicle. We are the place where he lives. Oh, I know. We can hug a tree and feel the Lord. We can see the formations in the clouds. I know, and that is true, and that's real. All creation, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the earth proclaims his handiwork. Every day pours forth speech. We know that. But his spirit is not indwelling that tree. His spirit is not indwelling the cloud, nor the animal. The dolphin does not have the Spirit of God indwelling him. But man does, those who know him. And so we are sent, we are launched out because the world needs to see him. So we gather together to know him more, to be more available to him. So when we're out there, they can see him. And God willing, they will know him. And there'll be more in here next week. Right? Not that the agenda is fill the pews. The agenda is fill the pews with his people and more people being his. It's the plan. And it's an eternal plan. And by us coming here this morning, we're saying, hey, I'm going to live forever. There's no cessation to my existence. How about that? You like that news? So, even though what came my way this morning wasn't trying to cease my existence, throws me off. It threw me off. And so now I come up, and it's my privilege to lead you in the study of the scriptures so you'll know the Lord more, and I can't do it. Well, then what am I doing up here? Well, the reality is, in his own strength, no one can. So if I come up here and give you the best that Wayne can give you, I'm wasting your time. And far be it from me to waste your time during this time. So it doesn't matter, in a sense, how I am. I mean, I appreciate you asking, Lord. The only good response would be, I'm dependent. Otherwise, I'm going to waste your time. So, I endeavor to be dependent. I'm going to make an announcement now because, as we've discussed last week, I don't always know. I kind of lose track right there at the end of the service for some reason. Last week, I was able to dismiss us properly, and but I did neglect last week to say we have a meeting after church. And so I'm going to say it now because we have another meeting after church today. And if I don't remember to say it at the end of the time, just you try to remember that we have a meeting after church.
We do have a meeting after church.
Yes, that's exactly right. They're going to try to remember the meeting after church. Thank you. Now, it's an important meeting. They all are, anytime we gather. It's an important meeting because we're going to be voting as members to see what God has been doing. To vote to say, Andrew and Kara and your six children, part of us. Or perhaps not. But it's what God's doing. So pay attention to the Lord when it comes time to cast the vote. But please cast your vote. Okay. So this is not where we are in Exodus. In Exodus, trusting you did your homework. Oh, I have another announcement. And that's Esther Fisher is still turning 100 tomorrow. Yeah, that hasn't changed, Lord willing, absolutely, because we don't know what tomorrow holds. Esther Fisher turns 100 tomorrow. Those of you who would like to celebrate that and sing with her, Esther and Prentice, right? I don't know where they used to sit. Right there. They were here for a long time. And so Esther turns 100, and you have been invited between 3 and 5 p.m. I look at Anne because she is the source of what's correct. Between 3 and 5 p.m., Good Samaritan, refreshments will be provided if you want to say and sing happy birthday, dear Esther, 100. At Good Samaritan's, which is an assisted living facility, and is it also, what else is that called?
Senior
apartment. Senior, right, you're the one I should be asking. It's a senior apartment. So it's on the north side of town by Sombrero Stables. Anyway, we can give you all the details if you want to go between 3 and 5. Okay, so that was the announcement. Now, this week I was reading. The other day I was reading, and it just struck me. So I'm going to show it to you. This is not Exodus. Exodus 25 through 30 is what we'll be covering this morning, I believe. But I just want to show this to you because it struck me. And when it struck me, I thought, well, maybe this is something I should talk about for just a few minutes. Ezekiel chapter 28. Please turn there, please. Now, I can't make this strike you the way it struck me, but I'm going to show it to you anyway. And it's not even going to seem that dramatic. I said it. Ezekiel chapter, I'm sorry. When I said I said, I was not referring to you asking. I was referring to me. I thought I said the wrong thing. Ezekiel 28, verse 13. Ezekiel 28, verse 11. Here in Ezekiel 28, in Ezekiel 27, there's a lamentation over the king of Tyre, which was a powerful nation to the north of Israel. In Ezekiel 28, there's a continuation, sort of a lamentation about the king of Tyre, who was an evil man. But when you read it, you recognize that the king of Tyre, in his evilness, is being used to explain to us Lucifer in his evil. So in Ezekiel 28, we're actually not learning about the king of Tyre. We're learning about Satan himself. Okay? Now, that's not the point that I want to explain, but I wanted to give you context. So in Ezekiel 28, verse 11, Ezekiel says, "The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation over the king of Tyre, and say to him, Thus says the Lord God, You had the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, topaz, diamond, beryl, onyx, jasper, lapis, lazuli, turquoise, and emerald, the gold workmanship of the setting sockets of your settings and sockets was in you on the day you were created. They were prepared." Stop there. This is what caught me. I was reading, and it said, "You were in Eden, the garden of God." Where's that first mentioned in the Bible? Eden, the garden of God. Where's that first mentioned? Genesis chapter 2. And then Ezekiel mentions it. I don't know how many years later Ezekiel was writing. 2,000 years later, 2,500 years later, Ezekiel is writing, I'm not certain. And he mentions Eden, all those years later. Turn to Isaiah, if you would, just a couple of prophets, three books back. Lamentations, Jeremiah, Isaiah, chapter 51. This is God speaking of Israel being restored after the time of discipline in the tribulation. Verse 1, "Listen to me, Isaiah 51, listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from whom you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who gave birth to you in pain. When he was one, Abraham, I called him. Then I blessed him and multiplied him. Indeed, the Lord will comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places. Her wilderness he will make like Eden, and her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and sound of a melody." Stop there. Isaiah wrote a little bit before Ezekiel. And Isaiah mentioned Eden. And he knew that Eden was the garden of God. And it was beautiful. Perfect. Isaiah knew it. Ezekiel knew it. Joel writes about it. And it's mentioned in Genesis chapter 2. You know what that tells me? Now look, I'm just me, right? I'm just a guy. There's nothing special about me. I'm the guy. I was a professional in the banking industry. Did anybody know that? Maybe all of you knew that. I was a banking professional. You know what my career was after I was a banking professional? I was homeless, sleeping on park benches, and sleeping behind bushes, and hiding, and trying to escape from the world, and planning where I was going to hermitize, and interviewing one or two hermits I bumped into to find out how to do it. It's not easy to bump into a hermit. I did it. And my goal was to be one of them. And God kept, I didn't know it, but God, four times he stopped me. I was on my way and I got stopped four different times, four different ways. The last time was when I finally met the Savior. Right? So that's What do I know? That was me. I knew nothing. And apart from the Lord, I still know nothing. So I'm just me reading the Bible, and God shows me the Garden of Eden is strewn throughout the scriptures. God shows me that Isaiah believed in the Garden of Eden, and he knew what it was like. And Ezekiel believed in the Garden of Eden, and he knew what it was like. And Joel believed in the Garden of Eden, and he knew what it was like. How did they know? Because God's word is real, sure, and true. And he has maintained it so we can sit here with it open in front of us. Thank God. I'll just tell a very personal story. I've already told you some. But seeing Justin and Rachel sitting here with their Bibles open, they're on staff at Ravencrest. And I remember, it's a Bible school in Estes Park here. And I remember one day I was teaching up at Ravencrest, and there were about 60 18-year-olds sitting there. 60 18-year-olds sitting there. And then we took a break. And at the break, mass exodus from the classroom, because they get out as if it's possible during the break after class. Let's go. Let's go outside. Let's go downstairs. Let's go somewhere, because we're going to be back in a few minutes sitting down and being in there again. So mass exodus, and I just kind of was standing there at the lectern, and our lectern up there is kind of the same size. Oh no, it's different now. And so I was standing there and looking, and I looked, and I said, wow. And I looked at every seat, 60 seats in every row, and without fail, every seat had an open Bible in front of it. So encouraging. 18-year-olds sitting there to know the Lord, study the scriptures, committing a year of their lives. So encouraging. And the Bibles are all over here too. I appreciate you young guys actually having Bibles instead of a phone. It's okay. Is that what you have, Denny? You have a phone? It's okay. Everybody's allowed. Okay. So your homework was Exodus chapters 25 through 30. I don't know if you read it. I'm not going to ask. You didn't have to. The way we're going to go through Exodus 25 through 30 is really just through a slideshow. Because you had the chance to read it in advance. So instead of reading it all together, which would be totally appropriate, we're just going to look at an overview of it. Exodus chapters 25 through 30 are six chapters devoted to Moses being on the mountain. That's where we ended in chapter 24. Moses on the mountain, about to receive the instructions for the tabernacle in the wilderness. Moses up on the mountain. Okay, so turn Exodus chapter 25. I'll read the first part of it, verses 1 through 9. We did read it last week as the benediction. Exodus chapter 25, verse 1. Then the Lord spoke to Moses. Moses is up on the mountain. He's just been called in on the seventh day. The mountain's on fire. The children of Israel are down at the base of the mountain. And they're looking at this mountain on fire for 6 days. And they don't know what's going on up there. Joshua's halfway up, more or less. Aaron and Hur are down in charge of the people. And the people are looking up. And Moses is up there, and I don't even know if the people could tell or knew that Moses on the seventh day was called in to the midst of the Shekinah, into the midst of the Shekinah glory, because God is up there. And I don't know if the people, the children of Israel, could see that Moses went in, but Moses tells us on the seventh day, God called him in. So he went in. Okay? Verse 18, chapter 24. Moses entered the midst of the cloud as he went up to the mountain. Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Verse 1. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Tell the sons of Israel to raise a contribution for me. From every man whose heart moves him, you shall raise my contribution. And this is the contribution which you are to raise from them: gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, and scarlet material, fine linen, goat hair, ram skins dyed red, porpoise skins, acacia wood, oil for lighting, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones and setting stones for the ephod and for the breastpiece." Stop there. It's a contribution. Go to the children of Israel. Now, how many of them are there at this point? How many children of Israel are there? 2.5 million, approximately. We don't know exactly, but we can extrapolate because we're told exactly how many young men like Caleb there are. These guys, there were 603,550 of them. Give them all a wife, because by the time you're your age, Caleb, in those days you would have had a wife. And also by the time you're your age, in those days you would have had a couple of children. So we just extrapolate from the number that God specifically gives us, 603,550 of those guys. 2.5 million. Raise a contribution. The word is teruma. It means voluntary. Go to the children of Israel and say, "Will you bring?" And what are the children of Israel to bring? Gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen, like, you know, the finest bed sheets. Bring it. Onyx stones, setting stones, fragrant incense, oils. So let me ask you a question. Before the children of Israel were in the wilderness, where were they? Where were the children of Israel before they were in the wilderness? Before they crossed the Red Sea, where were the children of Israel? Egypt. What was their occupation? Slaves. Where on earth could they have gotten gold, silver, bronze, blue, purple, scarlet material, fine linen, precious stones? Where on earth could they have gotten that? Pardon? From the Egyptians. Remember? God told Abraham back in Genesis chapter 15, you're going to be in there for 400 years or for four generations. And when you come out, Genesis 15, Abraham still has no son. Genesis 15, you're going to be a great nation. You'll be in that land as foreigners, enslaved, four generations, 400 years. When you come out, you will come out with many possessions. That's what God told Abraham. Moses knew that because Moses told the people, okay, tomorrow night, it's Passover, go to, that, this is just my paraphrase, tomorrow night's Passover, go to the people and ask for their gold. Ask for their silver. Ask for their bronze and their purple, their blue, fine, their purple, royalty. Ask for their finest. And so they did. And they gave it to them. Now God told Abram years, hundreds of years before, because he knew that hundreds of years later he's going to want to build a tabernacle. And the Egyptians were going to provide what they needed. Okay, let's keep going. Verse 8. Let them construct a sanctuary for me that I may dwell among them. Moses, build a sanctuary, a place that I may dwell among them. That word dwell, does anybody know in Hebrew what that word dwell is? You've heard me say it actually many times. Anybody know what that word dwell is? Shekinah. Shekinah? That's what the word is. When you think of the Shekinah, the Shekinah glory, you think of the presence of God. I want to dwell amongst them. I want to Shekinah be with my people. So build the tabernacle, because I just told you a few chapters earlier, you're going to be a holy nation. The only way you'll be a holy nation is if you've got the Holy One there, and that's me. Okay, let them construct a sanctuary for me that I may dwell among them. According to all that I'm going to show you as the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furniture, just so, Moses, you shall construct it. Okay, so Moses receives instructions. He's on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Just by way of reminder, actually, how many days? And did Moses eat anything while he was up there? No. Did Moses drink anything while he was up there? No. How many times did Moses do that? Three. Three 40-day periods and 40-night periods. 120 days, 120 nights. He didn't eat. He didn't drink. First time was on the mountain the first time. Second time was when he came down and they're worshiping the golden calf. He lays before the Lord 40 days and 40 nights, doesn't eat or drink. Third time is when he goes up the second time and gets the two tablets of stone a second time. 40 days and 40 nights, he doesn't eat or drink. Again, don't know that those are consecutive. 120, probably not. But it's pretty miraculous. And that's what Moses did. Okay. Any thoughts or questions before we look at a slideshow? I recognize we're not going to be reading a lot of scripture this morning. We've read some. Now we're going to look at a slideshow. Katie, if you would, please. Okay, so this one you've seen. And what do you call this? What do you call this? Shekinah. Dwelling. I want to live amongst my people. So I'm just going to give you an overview. It's just going to be a slideshow this morning, brethren. And just so you know, we may do this twice. The reason being is guess what chapters 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, and 40 in Exodus. 35 through 40. Guess what those chapters are totally about? Anybody know? Building this. Chapters 25 through 30 are instructions on building it. 35 through 40 are actually building it. It's like a repetition. So we may do this a second time. This is it right here. Holy nation. Here's your nation. 2.5 million. What makes them holy is the Holy One dwelling in their presence, dwelling in their midst. Okay? This is the courtyard right in here inside the linen fence. This is, I'm just going to go with our North American measurements. This is 150 feet long. 150 feet. Think about that in your mind. This is 75 feet wide. And this is so high that Justin cannot look inside. Goliath could have. Manute Bol. Anybody ever hear of him? I think he's the tallest basketball player ever to play basketball in the NBA. He was 7 feet, 7 inches. This is 7 feet, 6 inches high. 7.5 feet high. The linen fence. 7.5 feet high. Meaning, you can't look in. You can't look in. You can't look over. It communicates separation. Okay? Okay, so 150 by 75 by 7.5. Okay? Here's an entrance curtain. That entrance curtain is 30 feet wide. Here on the either side of the entrance curtain is the linen fence. which is 45 feet, 22 and a half on each side. All of these measurements are given. If you read 25 through 30, you read all of this. There are 20 of these posts, pillars, posts. On this side, 20 on that side, 8 in the back, 6 with 2 on the corner. No, sorry. 8 in the back, 8 in the front. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They doubled on the corners. 150, 75, 7.5. Okay? Inside of this linen fence, which is the fine twisted linen material, you have the temple courtyard. Inside the temple courtyard, you have right here your bronze laver. We're going to look at other pictures. Bronze laver. It's big. It's like 7.5 feet high, 7.5 feet wide and deep. It's big, with a ramp leading up to it, made of bronze. Bronze communicates judgment. It's where the altar is, where the animals were sacrificed. This is the bronze laver, made of the mirrors of the women. The measurement, the size of the bronze laver is not given to us, but it's big, and it's large enough for the priests, after coming from there, from the bronze altar, before going into the tent, that they could wash themselves, their hands, they could wash their feet. And they're looking, when they're washing, when they're seeing the blood wash off, this bronze laver is made of the mirrors of the women. So they can see, they're looking at the blood being washed off before they go in and serve the people. Okay? This is the tent. The tent is 45 feet long, 15 feet wide, and 15 feet high. It is twice the height as the linen fence, which means if you're outside, you can see the tent. And again, in the tent and even through the tent is Shekhinah. Let's go to the next slide, please. Okay, this is just another picture. It's just giving you the measurements. You can see these pillars. You can see here's the entrance curtain. This entrance curtain is blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen. This also, the tent, has an entrance curtain with 5 pillars, and it also is blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen. This tent is divided into 2 sections. Let's try the next one, Katie. Okay. Divided into 2 sections. In the first section, so here's the entrance curtain into the tent right here. Here are 4 pillars on which you're hanging. What's hanging on the 4 pillars? Anybody know? What's hanging on the pillars? A veil. And the veil is blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen. Look at this material here. The inner covering, the first covering that actually forms the tent, is blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen. In other words, the entrance curtain to the whole courtyard, the entrance curtain to the tent, that which forms the tent, and this right here on the high priest is blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen. It's all the same. It's all royal, and it's all the highest quality. Okay? Now, what you cannot see is interwoven in here are cherubim, cherubim being the highest order of angels. Here is the holy place. This is the east side, and this is the west side. East, west. The entrance is on the east. This most holy place is on the west. You enter going in from the east. See, if you're going in from the east, to your left would be the south side, is the lampstand. Seven-branched lampstand. In each of the seven branches, you have four almond buds, the top one being the one that holds the oil, and then three. And it's seven branches. This actually is the symbol of the nation of Israel even today. Not just the Jewish star, the six-pointed star, but this. If you were in Israel and you went, when you get out of the airport, at Ben-Gurion Airport, they have a giant lampstand. First thing you see, basically, when you come out. One of the first. This is solid gold. It's made of gold. Its exact measurement, we don't know, but that's a good representation of how big it was. Across from it, on the north side, is the table of showbread. Table of showbread, I believe it's a bit large for the measurements given. It's probably half of that from the measurements given, on which you have 12 loaves of bread, each loaf representing a nation of Israel, a tribe of Israel. Okay, this lampstand is illuminated every morning and every evening. In other words, it's always illuminated. The priest goes in every morning and every evening to make sure there is light in the lampstand. On the Friday evening, on Sabbath, these 12 loaves get changed once a week. In front of the priest, this is the high priest, in front of the high priest is the altar of incense. The incense is burning every morning and every evening. The priest goes in, every morning, every evening, the priest goes in to make sure that there's incense burning on the altar of incense. Okay? So, every morning, every evening, a priest goes in to make sure there's light in God's house and there's incense burning in God's house. Every morning and every evening. Now, does anybody know a story in the scriptures that talks about a guy doing just what this guy's doing, except he was not the high priest? A priest standing right there. Anybody know any story in the scriptures? King Uzziah? That could be. That could be. That's not the one I have in mind. Anybody know of another one? Think New Testament. Oh, can I think New Testament when it comes to the... Now, it was the temple, not the tabernacle. Can I think New Testament when it comes to temple and tabernacle? Can I? Was there a temple in the New Testament? Okay, good. So think New Testament, a guy standing in front of an altar of incense, a priest in front of the altar of incense. And he said, and an angel appears to him. And he says, I'm not going to give you his name. Your prayers have been answered. Zacharias, who's the husband of? Right. Your priests have been answered, Zacharias. Your wife, who's way too old to have any children, never had one, will have a son. Zacharias says, really? Is that possible? Only with God. That's where Zacharias is. And Gabriel appears at the right hand of the altar of incense. Okay? Okay, here's the veil. Okay, so this space from here to here, from the entrance curtain to the veil, is 30 feet long, 15 feet high, which means this space back here is 15 feet long, because the whole tent is 45. 30, 15. This space is 15 feet long, and you've got this veil separating it. Now, who's allowed into this space back here? The high priest. How often? Once a year on the Day of Atonement. What's back here? What is this? This is the Ark. The Ark of the Covenant, in which are the two tablets of stone, Aaron's rod which budded, and the golden jar holding manna. Okay? The ark, as I said the other week, is about this size, maybe even a little smaller, laying on its side. And it has a lid. And on the top of the lid, it's made of acacia wood, a hardwood, totally overlaid in pure gold, with poles so you can carry it. This has poles so you can carry it. This has poles so you can carry it. And it has a lid. And the lid fits perfectly on top. And on engraved on, not engraved, what do you call it? Formed out of gold, one piece of gold, on the lid are two cherubim. Because a cherub is the highest angel. And he serves in the presence of God. And this, see that glow right there? Shekhinah going through. That's a tabernacle. Okay, Katie. This actually exists, and it's in an area called Timnah in the desert of Israel, in the south of Israel. The furthest point in Israel today is a town called Eilat City. You go a bit north, about 45-minute drive, and you come to this. This actually is standing, and it's made to size. Patty and I slept just next to the bronze altar outside one time. So you can actually walk through the tabernacle. Okay, Katie? Okay, so here are your elements. These are the best ones I could find. Here's the ark. Here's the altar of incense. Here's the table of showbread, lampstand, bronze laver, altar of burnt offerings. Okay, Katie? Okay, next one. Next. Okay, these are the coverings. Now let's think about these coverings for a moment. Okay, so here are your five pillars for your entrance. You've got here are the pillars for your linen fence. Here are your guy lines. If you look here, you can see boards. They're acacia wood overlaid with gold. They're 15 feet high, 2.5 feet wide. Heavy acacia wood overlaid with gold. 15 feet high, 2.5 feet wide. You put 20 of them together and you get 45 feet. Okay? 15 feet high, 15 feet high, 15 feet wide. This is your blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen, same as your entrance curtain. This is your goat hair. This is your ram skin. And this is your porpoise skin. What forms the tent is 42 feet long, 6 feet wide, 42, 6, and there are 10 of them. Stitched together. Five are stitched. So you've got 42 by 30 is one curtain, 42 by 30 is another curtain. And these two giant curtains are joined by 50 gold clasps. Okay? So, if it's 42 wide by 60 long, I know it's the summer, we probably shouldn't be doing, is this algebra, geometry, some sort of math? If this is 42 wide, then, and if this is 15 up, 15 across, 15 down, it's 45. You're gonna have a foot and a half, off the ground. Okay? There are 10 of them joined by gold clasps. But if it's 15 by 15, that's 60. And so it's a full covering. That's the first one. Now, you guys have camped? Ever go camping? You have your tent, and then you have what do you have over your tent? Your rain tarp, rain fly. Well, there are three. goat hair. This is 45 by 6. So these, actually, you see how it's longer than that one? These drape, so the ram skin, the goat hair, the ram skin, and the porpoise skin all drape to the ground. 15, 15, 15 equals 45. And there are 11 of them. So they are longer and they fold over on the bottom. There are 11, 5 sewn together, 6 sewn together, joined by 50 bronze clasps. And that's your tent. Now, how they got those up on top, I don't know. Do you know how heavy that is? Anybody ever hunt one elk hide? How many ram skins, how many goat hides does it take to get 66 by 45 sewn together? How many goat skins? How heavy is that going to be? And then how do you get up there? Now, we have some engineers in this room, and you probably have answers. They didn't have a crane. How did they transport it? That instruction is not given. How did they carry, brethren, how did they carry these? Those are acacia wood overlaid with solid gold, 15 feet long, 2.5 feet wide. How did they carry them? Like this? Walking along. It's not given. Yes, sir. A pulley system is what that would be. May I know your name? Theodore? I have a grandson named Theodore. I like the name. Sorry. Pulley system. You have the rope, and you're pulling this way and lifting up and over, very possibly. You have to do it in such a manner that you don't pull these over. Anyway, that's your tent. Incredible. Next, please, Katie. Next one, please. Next. Next. Again. High priest. Blue, purple, scarlet material, fine twisted linen. This is a blue robe. This is a white robe. This is the ephod. No, this whole piece is the ephod. This is the breast piece. 12 stones representing each of the 12 tribes of Israel. Aaron was the first high priest, always has Israel on him. Always is serving on behalf of Israel. Right here, 2 shoulder pieces, onyx stones. 6 of the tribes engraved on one stone, 6 of the tribes engraved on the other stone. Aaron's always representing and bearing Israel. He's got a white mitre. It's a hat. On the front, he has a gold band, a gold plate. Anybody know what the gold plate says? Holy to the Lord. That's who Aaron is. Right here, what's on the bottom of his blue robe? Dried pomegranates with the seeds in them, which means every step he takes, it's... And bells, which means every step he takes, it's ding, 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 ding. And he has to be wearing that, so you always know where the high priest is. Okay? That's the tabernacle. Turn, please, to chapter 29. Verse 42. We're jumping into the middle of this explanation, talking about a daily sacrifice whereby God will maintain his relationship with Israel. A daily sacrifice is what he's explaining. Verse 42, that sacrifice, verse 42, shall be a continual burnt offering throughout your generations at the doorway of the tent of meeting before the Lord, where I will meet with you to speak to you there. And I will meet there with the sons of Israel, and it shall be consecrated by my glory. And I will consecrate the tent of meeting and the altar. I will also consecrate Aaron and his sons to minister as priests to me. And I will dwell among the sons of Israel and be their God. And they shall know that I am the Lord their God, who brought them out of the land of Egypt. They shall know that I am the Lord their God, who brought them out of the land of Egypt, that I might dwell among them. I am the Lord thy God. I am the Lord their God. How many times has he now said that? I am going to dwell. Katie, can you go back to the first one? I am going to dwell with them. And I'm going to meet with them. That's the whole point. Me and my people. So through my people, other people can know that I am God. Let's pray, and then the worship team can come up. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us the tabernacle. Thank you for giving us your scriptures. Thank you for maintaining them. I pray that as we discussed at the beginning, we know you more now than we did an hour ago. That's all that matters. Because as we know you, our well-being is based and found in you. It's not based and found in our lives or our circumstances or our interests or our preferences or our joys or our disappointments. Our well-being is never based in our. It's always based in you. And of all the people on earth, we must know that so we can tell others. Thank you for this time. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thanks.
Wayne, I neglected to mention to you prior to the service that we have only one song prepared for after your teaching today. And I'm telling you now so that we can be sure to be properly dismissed at the correct time.
Faithful forever.
Theodore calculated that the area of the courtyard is 1,800 square feet. Thank you very much. What's your sister's name?
Daisy.
Daisy? What are you two going to remind me of? You need to remind me of something. An announcement I need to make. What's happening next? You want, may I help you? We have a meeting. Remember? So here's a question. Was there a temple or a tabernacle in the Garden of Eden? No. That's true. They had no instructions. They didn't need them. Will there be a temple or a tabernacle in the New Jerusalem where we live forever? No, why not? Shekhinah, he's there. Perfection? Totally in the presence of God, everybody? No temple, no tabernacle. Perfection? Totally in the presence of God, his people, his children, New Jerusalem? He's right there. Is there a temple today? No. Is there a temple on earth today? Think spiritually. Brethren, you have to know this. Is there a temple on earth today? Who is it?
Us.
What more do we need to know? Shekhinah. We are where he dwells. Hang around for a meeting. You're dismissed.
Thank you.